Thanks everyone for coming. Maybe perhaps a slight correction in my CV. I don't teach at the Academy of Fine Arts, but liberal arts, and my course is called Theory of Ideology. So what I will talk about today falls roughly in this, let's say, in this general outline of theories of ideology, although it will not be a specifically theoretical lecture, more like a political intervention. But since political interventions are by definition rather localized and time-bound and so on, I will ask you to just use whatever you will find useful and disregard the rest, since the situation I'm addressing might be quite specific for Slovenian political situation with the rise in the new left, which one of its main causes is precisely a struggle against or defense against austerity measures and public cuts in public budgets, and a certain specific view on the public sector and public or social services. This might not be relevant for general or other national context. So I will begin with a short, let's say, description of the social and political situation. As I've said, since at least 2010, public sector in Slovenia, and probably at least in Europe at large, maybe worldwide, has been under attack. Let's put it this way, or at least this is official left way of framing it. Why I find it slightly unconvincing, I will tell in the course of the lecture. But let's say undisputed fact is that there have been austerity measures, there have been cuts in public budgets, in budgets for education, social services or social support. There have been some laying off of public employees. The wages have been frozen, which are probably processes from your local context or from the, let's say, paying attention to social and political situation in the European Union at large. Now in this specific situation, there were series of laws, some of them passed even by ignoring the official parliamentary procedure, like intervention laws or urgent laws, which increasingly, let's say, cut social rights, social entitlements, or even amounts of monetary social redistribution in the form of social support, unemployment benefits. When there have been a series of cuts in public education, culture, and so on, of course, it was tactically and pragmatically necessary for the left. I in no way disagree with this, to defend the public sector as such, to stand in the defense in this, let's say, specific situation of austerity measures and budget cuts, which were really severe and really intense, and sometimes also illegal, so carried out with disregarding the official networks of decision making or policy making. And not only do I think this is just to clarify where my critique of this left discourse lies. It's a comradely critique. Not only was unconditional defense of the public sector in such political situation justified, but it also brought into the public discourse the questions of universal welfare or universal social wage or universal social entitlements. It brought out the question of decommodified or decommodifying social services and so on. So not only did it help in defense of the public sector and social rights. It also, at least somehow, somewhat expanded the political horizon, the questions that are being posed, the problems that were being opened. But in the long term, at least I think this is the main motivation for my talk today, in the long term, this idealistic picture of public sector as a haven in this wild, out of control capitalist world. If we paint this idealistic picture of the public sector or the public institution of this idealized haven of democratic self-management, equality, and universal social provision, I think in the long run, let's say outside of this very concrete specific political situation. We risk, or the left risks, becoming politically irrelevant precisely in questions regarding the public sector. So to put it in another way, if we disregard the real problems, the real hierarchy, status-based hierarchies, the real cases of exploitation, although it might not be typical capitalist exploitation for profit, but still bad working conditions, long working hours, increasing intensity on work, and things like that also exist in the public sector. So at least I think in the long run, this unconditional defense of the public sector, especially if it's based on an idealized image of the public sector, is however noble it might be, or however justified it might be in some specific political situation, I think is in a long run self-defeating. I will try to explain this by focusing on three basic points. One is the question, the more pragmatic question of ideological efficacy of left-wing political discourse, the efficacy of left-wing political discourse that tries to ignore certain social realities. I will question its ideological, from pragmatic point of view, its ideological efficacy. And another point I would like to make will be the not so much pragmatic, but more principle, so a matter of political principle. In a sense, if we criticize and denounce exploitation in bad working condition, loss of personal autonomy in the private sector, it is at very best hypocritical if we do not address and criticize the same social relations of inequality, loss of autonomy, bad working conditions, exploitation, and so on in the public sector. And lastly, at the end of my lecture, I will also address the question of neoliberalism and its various definitions. Especially, I will criticize the image of neoliberalism as an external enemy, like something, some evil that descends on the innocent states or innocent public sector from above and wants to cut it, destroy it, and shrink it, and so on. And I will, in the end of my lecture, I will try to show that at least in Slovenia, neoliberalism is wholly first of all, it's indigenous to the public sector, and second of all, it's a matter of the state. It's a political project. So we cannot perceive neoliberalism as something that endangers the state. Quite the opposite. To anticipate my final point, neoliberalism is a state project. As such, needs the state as a vehicle of its policies. So, but To begin in the same order that I just anticipated my three main points. So the first point, the pragmatic point, ideological efficiency of both left wing and right wing discourse regarding the public sector. I think that the problem that is often overlooked in the defense of the public sector against austerity measures is the question or the problem of ideological efficiency, precisely of right-wing or neoliberal discourse, or the question that is never posed if we gloss over this question or if we write it off dismissively. This is just neoliberal elitist propaganda. This is just a propaganda of rich and greedy people who wants to make even more money by privatizing, cutting social rights. We still miss the question. Okay, maybe this is the main motivation on the part of wealthy bankers, politicians, and so on. But why is it so persuasive? I mean, this is the very basic question of ideological efficiency. If those same wealthy businessmen, bankers, and politicians would tell the people to accept certain policy in the name of the rise of Cthulhu or something quite imaginary like that, they probably wouldn't get voting support. They probably people would not believe them, would not take their ideology as credible. So the very basic question is what makes sense in neoliberalism for the common people. So why do people actually, from top down propagandistic view, it's probably quite obvious there are certain economical interests, some people get rich and so on, but the problem is this still doesn't explain why some people believe it quite passionately, why people are willing to go out in masses, out to the streets to protest against corruption, to demand technical governments, to protest against privileges in the public sector. Why are common people convinced to vote for parties that put out neoliberal programs? And I think the answer is precisely because neoliberal ideology, maybe in a distorted way, maybe in a cynical way, but still it touches some real life issues. It corresponds to some real life experiences of common people, common workers, employees, also public sector employees. So the advantage of the right on the terrain of the discussion of the public sector is precisely that it has no illusions about the public sector, but it brings out the very real problems that exist in the public sector, like this baroque neo-feudal hierarchies of status, especially, let's say, in the public education system, especially in the higher education, in the university system, where you basically still have, at least in Slovenia, maybe in Central Europe, Eastern Europe at large, you still have very medieval, very rigid hierarchies, which a lot of people don't like, both students and workers. So when neoliberal propagandists may be misleading people when they tell them if we allow market mechanisms and competition into university, we will destroy these hierarchies, or maybe they destroy them, but the new hierarchies that emerge are even worse than the old medieval ones, but still they touch the very real problem. So if you have this idealized view of the public university as a haven of free autonomous science and so on, if you disregard its very real issues, inequalities and so on, our political discourses will be completely irrelevant to people who are, of course, in their everyday life bothered by these inequalities, by medieval or at least pre-modern hierarchies, by the institutional inertia, by the conservatism of the content of the university courses and so on. And this holds true not only for the limited case of the university, but let's say for state administration, and public services as well. So my basic point at this point is that we cannot pretend that, let's say, long lines at the doctors do not happen, or let's say superficial treatment of patients, or let's say academic ignorance and inertia and conservatism do not happen, that let's say bureaucratic complications in state administration do not happen, because people experience them in their everyday dealings with these institutions. So if you say this doesn't exist, this is just neoliberal propaganda, we will miss precisely these real life experiences. So our political discourse will be inefficient, will not convince anyone. And another problem with this position, this is just neoliberal propaganda, is that we kind of take away or negate the very capacity of ordinary, it's quite an elitist position, we deny the very capacity of ordinary people to make a realistic judgment about their social, political situation, about their real life experience. So basically we say in a very traditionalist, maybe not in those precise words, but basically we assume a very orthodox, very traditionalist Marxist position, whereas the masses have false consciousness, and now we have to enlighten them with true consciousness, like false consciousness is the very real experience and frustration with state administration, long lines at the doctor, or superficial treatment of the patients, or humiliations in the centers for social work and so on. So I think the problem is, even if you don't want to be elitist and arrogant, we cannot idealize the public sector without reducing a neoliberal treatment of the public sector and let's say people's acceptance of this kind of political discourse to just false consciousness. So basically, if we deny that there are real problems in the public sector, all we can say to the people who act politically by choosing people who touch these real problems, let's say right-wing or neoliberalists, the only thing we can say to them is, you have false consciousness, so we will reveal the Marxist or left-wing truth to you. Just listen to us, and you will see that the problems in the public sector are just an illusion. I'm caricaturing slightly, but basically this is the position we have to take if we do not acknowledge the real problems of the really existing problems of the really existing public sector. Now, to move to my second point, the more principled, the first one was more like pragmatic, a question of political ideological efficiency. Now the second point is a principled point that I arrived at when I was thinking after the last wave of massive protests in Slovenia, that was, I think, about two years ago, that the main discourse of this, or the main demand of this discourse was, as it is often the case in the Eastern post-socialist Europe, was a demand for the cleansing of the political space to remove corruption and corrupted politicians. And in certain moments, these protests also got a very unpleasant authoritarian tinge, like in calls for technical government instead of democratically elected ones, or in the calls for increased authority of the police and judges and the criminal courts to finally punish all of those corrupt and rotten people. So left-wing or at least a radical left-wing response to this type of discourse was to try to show, which I think it was quite correct and justified, to try to show that the main problem, or at least not the only problem, is the corruption in the state, in the state politics or state administration, but that if you look at the capitalist society as a whole, there is, you also have a problem of production, of course, production for profit, exploitation in private economy, and that this is the real issue. So that we should focus on the production for profit instead of for people's needs, to focus on unemployment, which is produced basically because the goal of capitalism is not to ensure the good life for everyone, but to make profit for some, so people get unemployed, people get poor, and so on. And even if they do work, even if they're lucky enough to have a job, they're exploited. They cannot choose how to do it, what to do it, but they're under this pressure of this impersonal profit and competition imperative, which is of course it's more or less clear, and it's a left-wing common sense, but I think now retrospectively that this position also did not go far enough. It also stopped at the point that okay, there are problems in the private sector. We should not neglect these problems of private capitalist economy and the social ills that it produces. But it also stopped short. I think at this point we should also make the full circle and then go back. Okay, now we have cleared the issue of the private sector, but now let's look back to the state sector or the public sector and present a left-wing view or left-wing interpretation or left-wing critique of the corruption, clientelism, and so on. But this never happened. So again, corruption was kind of left out of the picture or of the left-wing political discourse as another kind of false consciousness, in a sense that there were some explicit texts in the left-wing media that precisely denounced the critique of corruption as some kind of false consciousness, in a sense workers of the world, or at least workers of Slovenia, you are being deceived in pseudo problems by the propagandists of the capitalist regime. Abandon your quest to end corruption and focus on what really matters, which is of course private economy, capitalist social relation. But I don't see a logical necessity here. I don't see how fighting against and criticizing exploitation, production for profit in the private sector in any way necessarily excludes a critique of corruption and clientelism in the public sector. Of course, there is in certain sense a primacy, at least if we stick to classic Marxist theory, there is in a certain sense a primacy of economic relations, in the sense that they're being productive, at least in capitalist societies, they're productive of value, the same economic value which is then secondarily recycled and redistributed through taxation and budget policies, and lastly through social programs and institutions. So in this broad, very broad picture of generic capitalist societies, of course, fate and the very fate and the manner of functioning of the public sector and of the state as an institution is of course tied to the fate and fortune of the private economy, its rates of growth, the rates of tax income, because the rates of tax income depend on economic growth, and public budget of course depends on the rates of the text income. So as the classical Marxist wisdom goes, one has to change the economic base, to change the social, political, legal, and so on superstructure. But the problem is that the primacy, however defined, of economic relations over, let's say, the political, the legal, and the social ones, this primacy matters little to those who are experiencing daily humiliation in the office of unemployment, where people come to find a job, and it's a public institution, of course. People come to get a job, and what they get instead are humiliating seminars where you learn how to make eye contact and how to shake your employer's hand with confidence, so that you show that you are a can-do, go-getting person. So and this primacy of the economic is also completely irrelevant, or matters little to those let's say single mothers who are experiencing invasive surveillance after the new social law, or the law of social services in Slovenia, that was passed in 2011, that presupposes inspectors who can go unannounced and uninvited to the homes of private apartments of women who are registered as single mothers, and by being single mothers entitled to welfare, to state welfare monetary support. But there are also inspectors who can come to their homes unannounced to check if they do not secretly have a husband or a partner, because if they would have a relationship in secret, they would be cheating the state, because they would still receive the welfare transactions. So this primacy of the, and this is of course a public policy, this is a policy carried out by the state in the public sector. So also for these single mothers, it matters little the primacy of the economic, or the primacy of the fight in the economic spheres. And it also matters little to people like me who struggle in the university, who put their job on the line every time they open Marx's Capital instead of Bourdieu's Cultural Capital in class, and who know that they will be marginalized for decades before they get anything resembling a decent salary and decent employment benefits and so on. So all of these class-like hierarchies, of course, they're not classic class relations in the public sector. Of course, you do not have production for the market and for the profit. So those relations of domination and insubordination between different type of employees are not class relation in this Marxist sense, but this also matters little to people who are experiencing them. They're still subordinated, there are still inequalities of income and of status, of course, especially in public hospitals, where you have very well paid and respected doctors, and then at the bottom of the institution you have nurses who work on an irregular or part-time basis, who are paid below poverty, before wages below official poverty line. So also for these nurses, it is also the same if this exploitation is a classical capitalist one, or is let's say non-profit exploitation and subordination of certain types of workers in the public sector. So for all of those peoples, the primacy of the economic relations and or the changes in the economic base matters very little. I mean, if you take into account the history of Marxist socialist attempt to change the capitalist base, not even their grandchildren might live to see the revolution in the economic base, and there is also in the cultural sector At least in Slovenia, there is quite open and unashamed clientelism and conservatism, at least in the national, big national cultural institutions. So when we complain about the program of the national theaters, there is also a sense and also a political space to change something without waiting, probably, to intervene, to change something without waiting for this huge revolution in the economic base. So basically this second point is that even within the capitalist society, or the society in which its economic relations are organized in a capitalist way, there is of course still a room to move, to intervene politically, to change public institutions, the way they are organized, the way they function, either through parliamentary reforms or from protest pressure or syndicalist pressure from within, or trade union pressure and organizing from within. So economic relations do not determine the public institution 100%, so changes are still possible even before this huge revolution in the economic base. Now to move to my third and last point, the problem of neoliberalism. This is also in a way a theoretical problem, a problem how from which perspective and with which conceptual tools we approach neoliberalism, and let's say common sense left-wing approach, at least in Slovenia's radical left, was to see neoliberalism in more or less Harveyan way, let's say, according to the Harvey's book, A Short History of Neoliberalism, as a concerted, almost conspiracy-like project to reassert class power of the capitalist class, however we defined capitalist class, or as if the capitalist class had a single homogeneous interest and was capable of acting in this unified homogeneous interest. So it is, and it's thus seen neoliberalism as an external enemy that is sometimes hard to localize. It appears under these phantasmatic or phantomic names of international capital or financial capital, and when it appears more concretely, at least in the left-wing imagination, it appears as some darkness descending from Berlin and Brussels. Because Berlin is where Angela Merkel lives, and Brussels is where the European Commission lives. So it is somehow imagined that they spread this darkness of neoliberalism over innocent and suffering peoples of the European periphery, over innocent and suffering working classes or working measures. And it's also another dimension of, let's say, the stereotypical view of neoliberalism is it's also partial. It sees only the, let's say, negative or destructive side of neoliberalism in privatization, austerity, and budget cuts, which of course this is in no way questionable. Budget cuts do destroy certain parts of the public institutions, and privatization destroys public companies or public institutions wholesome, because it turns them into private companies or private institution. I don't think this view is wrong. I just think it's partial. So this in a way touches some real issues, but only tells half of the story, while the other half, which we could call in a Foucauldian sense productive, and let's say in a sense in which Foucault writes about the positive aspect or dimension of social power, its productive aspect, that the power is not exclusively something that represses and negates, but it also produces new social realities, new social relations, new institutions, new discourses. So this kind of stereotypical left-wing view kind of negates this, let's say, productive, positive dimension, not positive in a moral sense that positive is good, but positive in productive as productive of new institutions, new discourses, new power relations, and it also overlooks what is even more important, the productiveness of neoliberalism, both as discourse and as a political and social practice, from within the public sector and the public institutions themselves. I think it's not the view that neoliberalism is imposed from without on public institutions. It's not only misleading, it's wrong. It's very simply wrong. Neoliberalism is precisely not some ideology which some rich people or businessmen and capitalists would force upon or impose upon public institutions. At least not. I don't want to generalize too much. Maybe this happened elsewhere, but at least not in the case of the public institution of Slovenia. In Slovenia, the main problem is, and this is why precisely I think that it's not enough just to defend an idealized public sector. Neoliberalism, at least in Slovenia, emerged as a discourse, as an ideology, as organizational, institutional practice, emerged precisely within the public institutions. Let's say specifically neoliberal manners of behavior, institutional relations and discourses, let's say discourses on excellence, on competition, on the necessity of quantification of results of public institutions' work and so on, emerge precisely within this institution, within the school system, within the social institutions or institutions that take care of social welfare and monetary social redistribution. So there has been at least 20 years now or maybe even more of a completely endogenous, autonomous production of neoliberal discourses and practices, and to verify that it's enough to just open national newspapers in Slovenia on any given day and to search for let's say signs or traces of neoliberal discourse. They will almost never come from private entrepreneurs. When entrepreneurs give interviews or write articles, Of course, they move within this, let's say, typical confines of capitalist ideology. They praise the market, maybe say something bad about the state, complain that taxes are suffocating them, and so on. But this, let's say, specifically neoliberal discourses on excellence, on this ethical, on the necessity of this inner micro individual ethical transformation of people to become more creative, more adapted, more open to the world, more flexible, and so on. And all of these apologies for the flexibilization of the labor market, for the flexibilization of social policy, and so on, they're coming from within the public institution. They're coming from within the faculty that I work at. They come from faculty of economics. They come from various government ministries and their related think tanks and so on. Also, the institutional innovations limitations are also, let's say, self-imposed. There has never been a case in, let's say, Slovenia's history of neoliberal reform of the public sector that some wolves from Wall Street would emerge with suitcases full of dollars and impose or bribe somebody at the public institution. This whole process was entirely autonomous. Of course, not without resistance, but in the way that it happened, in the way that it progressed, it was autonomous. Of course, sometimes there was European Union pressure, but we shouldn't neglect that this kind of autonomous neoliberal reforms of the public institutions happened not even before the crisis and the demand for austerity measures from European Commission, but even before Slovenia even joined the EU. Some of the most significant reforms in the direction of neoliberalism were carried out even before the EU and the European Commission on these public institutions and so on. And also another important point regarding this third point about neoliberalism. Also, if you take neoliberalism not just on this micro level, how institutions change themselves and what makes them want to become a neoliberal, which is a much harder and complicated question than projecting everything on some external evil in a sense of evil capitalists or evil rich people and so on. This is precisely the question: why do middle cadres within the public institution, within the centers of social work, so enthusiastically embrace neoliberal reforms, propose them, carry them out sincerely and so on. But also, if you talk about neoliberalism in general, we also should not disregard that this is also not neoliberalism as such is not something that capital does, however we define or imagine capital as a social subject or a social actor, but it's precisely a state project. So even if it does not come from within the various public or social institutions, it is always a state project. It is the state governments and state ministries that flexibilize the labor markets. It is not the private sector militias. Some people misleadingly call neoliberalism market fundamentalism. If this was market fundamentalism, then probably some fanatical private sector militias would arm themselves and encircle the parliament and the national government. But neoliberalism does not happen in this way. It is always precisely governments and government ministries that carried out. It is not the organized capitalists that carry out flexibilization of the labor market. It is not organized capitalist class that carries out austerity measures, changes in social policy. It is precisely the state government. So neoliberalism is a state project. Is a state political project, and this also complicates matters. We cannot put. We also cannot perceive a social, let's say, the main social contradiction as the market or the private economy on the one hand and the state on the other, because the state is at the very heart of neoliberal policy. So far from being a safe refuge from this neoliberal frenzy, it is at this very heart. The state is the main actor of neoliberal policies and reforms. So I will conclude with this and can open the discussion.
Session. I find your analysis super interesting, and I like when you're replacing actually the neoliberalism as a leftist problem, and inherently in some sense. And I see a prominent example in this in elements such as bitcoins, which are seen as a total freedom away from both state society and from capitalist society. There's this idea that with bitcoins we're finally free, and in strange rights which are being accommodated by a neo-rights and a neoliberalism and a post-left, such as rights for prostitution in France, which are a big debate right now. And it seems as though, in your description, neoliberalism is less capitalism with a human face than a socialism with a human face, where the basic notion is don't mind me and let me exist, which seems to be a leftist proposition. So I agree with this replacement, and also we see in France that those most antagonistic to neoliberal propositions are often right-wing radical fringes, which are, for instance, very against any biological mutation, if it's about women's bodies, the freedom to deal with your own body, the freedom to maybe market your body, which is a neoliberal value in some sense. So I'm just wondering if basically criticizing neoliberalism isn't already criticizing leftism itself in this complicated and not very clear manner. With the evolution of leftism after the fear of embodying power in itself.
Ah, you mean this in these cases, like body modifying or in general?
In general, because I'd say one of the most prominent actors of neoliberalism was Tony Blair, the new left, and that is something that we're now living in France quite strongly. And so a big leftist proposal from our leftist government is to make all the notaries privatized and not to have the state protect notaries. And so yes, it's an interesting way of looking at neoliberalism as a new leftist value, but I would go that far.
I don't know really, maybe, but I would say neoliberalism, well, at least in my local area, became a kind of a supra political, maybe not ideology, maybe even something different and at the same time deeper, because ideology is always pinned to certain political party or certain political choice. So you can say I'm a conservative, I'm a left wing, I'm a liberal, and so on. But there are some let's say. Some manners of perceiving politics and acting not only in your political behavior but also in everyday life that transcend these let's say divisions, which was probably half a century ago. This was probably some kind of a social liberalism, so belief in personal and human rights, but also belief in social welfare, state redistribution. I think maybe neoliberalism now has become such a, let's say, deep lying common sense, or how to call it, which is different before any certain political choice. So that's why you can have a left-wing neoliberal government and the right-wing, and then they fight. This was the case in Slovenia. Then they fight precisely about questions of abortion, control over your own body, the issues of is it possible to let's say market it, and let's say this extreme or fringe right questions, but they agree on fundamental issues. And I think also neoliberalism in some sense maybe gained this position of the common sense of certain epoch precisely because it did not censor or limit itself. I mean, probably Gary Becker's suggestion that marriage, the inventor of the human capital theory, his suggestions in the 60s that marriage is just another commodity exchange that can be perceived and regulated by contracts between contract subjects was probably outrageous in the 60s, and now it's common sense. A lot of people in America do marriage contracts and premarital contracts, regardless whether they are left and right. I don't know if I answered, it was just an association.
I'd say so. To me, then, the temptation witnessing this new common sense of neoliberalism, which is very prominent in the right and the left, I would say, especially when they only criticize the public sector, only criticize the private sector and not consider the public sector, is precisely to go back to a more orthodox version of Marxism, which is the first one you criticized as being the problem. But it's true that when there is such a consensus in the liberal parties and in the left representing the liberal parties, I'm just wondering if it isn't precisely that is needed, which is obviously complicated in a socialist country. But what tools would you have to counter this normalization of the neoliberal project? And isn't your critique in itself furthering it? Because if we do go back to a critique of the state, aren't we just enacting that neoliberal logic?
I wouldn't say so. I mean, this is, of course, I mean, critique of the state is always, today, always risk that. But I don't think it's wise from a principled and pragmatic point of view to avoid this risk. Because I think, first of all, what is important, neoliberalism does not have a problem with the state. So it has certain problems with democracy and popular representation, but it does not have a problem with the state as such, a state as an institution that enforces the legal order. Quite the opposite. I mean, in the classical neoliberal authors and also ordoliberal German authors, the state is in the center of their attention. They just don't like ordinary people voting, to put it simply, but they don't have any problem with status, the state as such, as long as it is at least in part authoritarian. But the problem, of course, every time you critique the state and the public sector, you risk being a useful idiot for the right. But if you don't do it, you will never. This is the point I was trying to make. You will never address a real issue. So you will never have anything to do with people who experience the same inequalities in the public sector. You will be, but this is not just completely pragmatic. You have to convince people to vote for you if you want to have good voting success, but also you need to be aware of the situation to also change it if you mean it seriously. And the public sector as it is, to mildly put it, far from perfect. So there has to be some kind of a way to approach it critically. And I think this is a good start, just to say, to go the other way around. So starting point at the protest that I was mentioning was, okay, corruption, but this is just some politician takes 100,000 euros and we protest, but profit means that some private businessman takes 100,000. This was the argument, which I think was quite good. Some private businessman takes 100,000 euros every day, so we should protest against too and problematize exploitation, capitalist economic relation, and then we could just go back and say, okay, this corruption in the public sector is just as bad as exploitation in the private, and I don't think we fall into the hands of the right wing if you take it like this, because the right wing will say there is nothing wrong with the private sector. They have blind spot on the private sector, so they will say everything is perfect as long as the state does not interfere. So everything is perfect. So you should just implement market mechanisms in the public sector, but then you can answer no. If we implement market mechanisms, it will be 100 times worse, because then you will have profit, not just corruption. Because corruption is isolated incidents, profit is just continuous routine, everyday private appropriation of commonly produced something value.
Thank you. but that's also why I would want to go back to maybe a more orthodox version of Marxist understanding, which would just call the state a bourgeois state, and therefore not a state which really actually fulfills the democratic purposes of a state, which, at least for me in the EU, seems quite obvious and relevant, like that there is little to defend in what they're even seeking to do. So that's also why I personally don't have an answer, but maybe these older understandings of the state, not naively seeing the state as an attempt to social justice, but actually just as a dominant tool for higher classes. Therefore, the critique of the state is inherent. But where I find a problem and danger is when the left precisely abides with the neoliberal logic of the state is negative, but we're talking about this state, we're not talking about maybe different forms of states which can emerge and can be more progressive at different points in different countries. But that's just me going back to this older critique of the state and not accepting that these are liberal democracies in their positive mean, but that they are dictatorship of the bourgeoisie and all its understanding.
Yeah. I mean, I agree on this point. I just don't know if I want to start with the state theory debate. I mean, of course, the state is not a tool of the ruling class, precisely because the ruling class does not exist as such. I mean, there's no homogeneous body of people that have common united interests. Precisely what makes bourgeoisie, even if you accept this term, is that they have opposing interests. So. Maybe
there is a good segue to make between this critique Primož just gave of the public sector and simply the question what kind of political or other subject will carry this critique on to, I don't know, either politically, institutionally or otherwise implemented. But you can go on talking maybe about the Polanski critique of the state, that is also, but it's a big chunk.
Well, one of the strong points of neoliberal movement, if you can call it that, is precisely that it does not have a single institutional actor. I think this is maybe the most important political innovation, whether we agree with it or not, of neoliberalism, of this common or general social and political movement, that there was never no party, political party that called itself neoliberal or would declare we are the neoliberal party, vote for us and so on. But at certain point, most of the parties, at least said political parties in European Union, including the Labour Party in the Great Britain, in England, and socialists in France, were adopting neoliberal policies and using its discourse. So I don't know precisely how that happened, but this is precisely the point maybe where we should learn from the neoliberals, especially regarding the questions of political efficiency, not from their content and what they do, but how they did it. It was precisely not this classical both left and right wing strategy. First we make a party, then we gather enough votes to take state power, then we implement whatever we want to implement. But at a certain sense, it was precisely, it was a kind of strategy that most Marxists would roll in their graves if they heard about it. It was a kind of elitist intellectual strategy. So it was changing the superstructure before changing the base. So creating all of these networks of formal and informal think tanks and the whole Mont Pelerin society and so on. But there's also, I don't know how they proceeded from this stage to the programs of the most political parties, but this is certainly an important question.
Anyone else?
Yeah, you have stressed the autonomous nature of neoliberal ideology spreading throughout the public sector as something that has a logic in itself and that we perpetuate. But this wasn't true when neoliberalism was born. It was imposed on other countries and it became the norm after decades of conditioning neoliberalism for loans, etc., etc. And so, to what extent don't you think that this autonomous activity within public sphere is actually conditioned by a larger global market where each country has to become competitive according to this logic? And in this sense, is it autonomous anymore? Because, I mean, today you've quoted Foucault, you also said that where power is diffused, and so we are as much creating power as much as power is having an impact on our ideology, etc. But to what extent has this dialectical relationship been closed by the fact that there is a proposition that there is no more alternatives anymore to neoliberalism, and so you can only function within that space, even in the public sphere?
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, of course, it was not public institutions in Slovenia that invented neoliberal discourse and institutional relations and so on. Of course, in the first phase, at least, it came from elsewhere. It came in the form of seminars for public employees, whereas people from some private institutions sometimes. From business would come and hold seminars on efficient public management and so on. But then there is the question, I don't have an answer, I would need much more research to find out why, but the fact is that it was embraced very positively, so there was very, very little resistance. So a colleague of mine wrote a PhD, which I haven't read yet, on the discourse of pedagogy in Slovenia, how it changed from the socialist self-management to incorporation of, let's say, some post-modernist views on education and upbringing of children that became to resemble, although it was historically had different sources, but became both in discourse and in institutional practice, began to resemble some basic neoliberal tenets, so to speak. So this is, this colleague of mine basically made a case study why neoliberalism functioned or was embraced so eagerly within the departments for pedagogy, andragogy, the very departments that have a very important role in shaping of the national education policy. So these very people who on their own came to certain positions that were starting from Marx's all around developed personality, which was the official doctrine in the 70s, with the socialist school reform in the 70s, then adding some of this postmodern permissive education, and then they have arrived on their own to some positions to which neoliberal, let's say, doctrine fit quite perfectly. So, and it was then these people that sent memos to the government, to the ministry, this is how education policy should be done, and then ministry prepared the education reform and so on. But of course it wasn't, it didn't originate in the public institution. What is interesting is that at a certain point, no external pressure was anymore needed. So things took a swing on their own and began to reproduce themselves on their own.
On their own, due to the historical situation of the 1990s and the fading away of the, however imperfect, main alternative to capital, which was socialism, and hence leaving the space for liberalism to take its most raw shape, and where power is naked, so in the periphery countries you can see that even more. But so when the possible was became ideologically impossible for history, for a historical situation like the 1990s, which today has been questioned again. I mean, today we're not having the same debate as we were in 1990s. And so in my view, I don't know, I mean, you said you didn't want to go into the theories of states, etc., etc. Perhaps this is where we should go into if we want to find a solution to this problem.
Yes, I mean, it's not that I don't want to go into theory of the state, but I sometimes cannot stop myself if I go. So this is just it's one of my most it's one of the areas that I'm most interested in. But maybe before we go into that, just a short reply on the there was no alternative, and or the main alternative was not practically existing and was moreover politically and ideologically discredited, which is of course true, but there is still quite a way, maybe not such long way, but still quite a way between this standard social democratic corporativism and neoliberalism. So this is, I don't have the answer. I would have to study this much more closely, but I think that certainly did happen, that even let's say this modest corporativism was slowly but surely replaced by neoliberal ideas and discourses and practices. So it wasn't certainly the breakup of the socialist system was certainly a factor, but probably not the only one. Regarding state theory, I don't know where should we start. Maybe if we try to put it more specifically.
State theory, where we already do a dichotomy between public and private sector with a nation state, that we could have a theory of the states with no nation state, like what is currently happening in northern Syria, where they have freed themselves and they are self-organized on the local assembly basis, and where the possible has been introduced again in ideological horizons of people, which is not the case here if we look at the states in such manner. So that could be a start of talking to theories of state.
Yeah. I mean, yes, of course. I mean, it certainly helps radical imagination if we go out of this rigid, rigid dichotomies, but in a sense of imagining, a future better society. But they still, I mean, that doesn't mean that they do not exist. I mean, it's not a distinguishing between public and private sector, it's not a conceptual rigidity, it's a really existing social, social rigidity. I mean, in all capitalist society, state exists as something, I don't know the correct English word, externalized. No, of course, not completely independent, but externalized from the economy, precisely so the economy could remain capitalist. Because the state has to enforce recognition of the market actors as at least formally free and equal individuals. So and also to prevent this equal individual to stab each other over commodities, so they have to respect each other. I mean, this is the most common point, as commodity owners, and there has to be an institution which is independent of any partial private interest, and this is the bourgeois state, let's say. But of course, I do not deny that any kind of, I mean, here I stick to the also classic and maybe futuristic theory of the state, that and this is quite unorthodox, at least for Slovenian left wing. I don't think that any really just and equal society is possible while the state exists. I mean, it has to be, it's not, I think in this more principled, let's say, basic political orientation, I don't really think, not only that the really existing public sector today is not the answer, but I don't think that public sector can even achieve this idealized picture as long as we do have a capitalist society with its state as it is.
That's so, isn't neoliberalism tapping into that sentiment that precisely states can't do much? And this is what I mean by a new left in neoliberalism, is that we do understand through the socialist experience that states cannot organize this perfect utopian society, etc., etc., but it has to come from an inherent will of individuals and of populations organizing themselves. And that's what I mean by it's a socialism with a human face. Neoliberalism, it's saying the state can't do anything, therefore we'll let the markets do it. And obviously the state is the main player in generating a market that takes over society.
I completely agree. I mean, neoliberalism works precisely, is efficient precisely because it taps into sentiments. If you don't tap into the same, distrust of the state, you become irrelevant. Precisely if you don't tap into sentiments in this maybe Deleuzean sense, if you don't tap into these flows of desire that are trying to escape the state or at least put some distance between people and communities and the state, and if you are this old-fashioned socialist who say, no, let the state handle it, of course it won't work. It didn't even work the first time. But of course, if you look at neoliberalism in this sense, that it activates some very real political desires or taps into them, then maybe even this dichotomy between classical right wing and left wing, and especially if you equate left wing with the defense of the state and the right wing with the defense of the market, they're kind of useless in a sense. Maybe not completely, but at least inhibiting.
Maybe posing a question. we already have this interpolation against the state in the media. You know, this the public sector is too large, too unorganized, too inefficient, and all of that. So, what would be some maybe possible avenues? Have you thought about it? And how could we politically or otherwise engage in that? Almost like a placeholder that could be used for something else rather than the simple eradication of budgets and the privatization of the public sector. And maybe if you don't think that the state, which from a left perspective is something that is making like attempting at something more of a equilibrium as opposed to the natural state, idealized natural state where everybody is the enemy of everybody else. Do you think that maybe if not the private sector, if not the public goods, maybe commons is somehow here a perspective, so something that is for everybody, but somehow democratically organized and in small localities, so more to the closer to the ground.
Well, regarding this, let's say micro level argumentation against neoliberal arguments, I think one has to take it case by case basis. There is no general guideline. For example, but it's not that hard. You just have to take some time. For example, when the right wing says the state takes your money through taxes, you just reply. These are quite common sense observation. Like the private entrepreneurs do not take money out of your pocket. This whole argument that the state takes some money away from you rests on the quite unrealistic assumption that private entrepreneurs give away goods for free. If you buy a smartphone from a private entrepreneur, you also give it the money, just like you give money to the state when you pay taxes. So I mean, so you can make a counter argument for every one of these simplified basic arguments. You just have to go through them, I don't know, case by case. Now regarding commons, I don't know, probably. I mean, probably in this very, very general sense, where you precisely try to break away from this public-private dichotomy, try to carve some space and at least imagine, if not practice something outside this logic. What I find unconvincing in the commons proposal as they are, and I've talked about this in Zagreb already, is that they mostly focus on the commoning the final product and commoning the resources. So what is missing is precisely what happens in between the raw, and let's say mostly when you talk about commons, you talk about the lakes and the trees and the forests and the sea and so on, and also raw resources, minerals, and so on, and then or you talk about the food as commons, for example, or housing as commons and so on. But what is missing is precisely, again, classically Marxist, the process of production that happens in between the raw material and the final product. And I think this would be an interesting perspective. I think Daniela Dolenec also wrote about this, that to be coherent in this talk about commons, you should stop avoiding this skeleton of self-management that is in the closet, that you have to take it out. And to talk about the commoning the process of production, which could be a really interesting departure.
Because an interesting thing that was left in my mind during all these years of being and participating on the left was that at least there was this acknowledgement that the public sector there are problems that was like crossed over with a short like but at least it is a space which is nominally democratically accountable. And then when you enter into question what that nominally democratically accountable means, well, you can go into the elections and then there is a party and it is responding to the will of the electorate, and then we are back to the question of how do we win the state with a party. So that was
I mean, this is of course not irrelevant. I mean, this can be also be useful everyday argument. One of the strong points of the even diminished and limited democratic accountability of the public institutions is that corruption and clientelism in the public sector is at least a scandal. That doesn't mean that scandal necessarily solves it, or that media scandal, or that changing after the media scandal, changing the responsible person will prevent such thing. Far from it. But at least it's a scandal. It's something, because in private sector, the old Benetton guy dies or retires, and then passes the company Benetton to his son, which is of course a case of nepotism if there ever was one, but it's not even a scandal in private sector. Nepotism, clientelism, I mean, it depends on the private judgment of the owner of the company. If he wants to employ, he can employ his whole family and nobody can protest. You cannot debate this decision, even with these limited bourgeois democratic methods. You cannot dispute this decision. This was.
Should we close?
Yeah.
Maybe you can outside.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.